Today,
ಸರಿ ನೋಡಿ,
ವಿ ವಿಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದಿ ಡಿಸ್ಕಷನ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಮಾಡ್ಯೂಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಸಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಮೈಕ್ರೋ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲರ್ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮಿಂಗ್ ಯೂಸಿಂಗ್ 8051. ಇನ್ ದ ಪ್ರೀವಿಯಸ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸಸ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ದ ಡಿಸ್ಕಷನ್ ಆರ್ ದ ರೀಕ್ಯಾಪ್ ಆನ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಟು ಕಂಪ್ಯೂಟರ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ಸ್. ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಲರ್ನ್ಡ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದ ಕಂಪ್ಯಾರಿಸನ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೈಕ್ರೋ. We also have discussed about the comparison of microprocessor and microcontrollers, architecture of 8051, the functional block and the pin configurations. Start my name. So let us have an introduction to the module that we go into. Let us consider the example of A equal to B plus C. So if this equation is to be executed, say through a software, then you can write this in different forms using either a high-level language programming, an assembly program, or the machine language. So when you talk about the machine language programming, it means that it's all the combination of ones and zeros. A very tedious job. But the same instruction, that is A equal to B plus C, can be written in the high level, usually and C programming as well as the assembly. So we understand from this equation that A, B and C are three variables, and then we have the execution unit as plus done by the ALU. So our main intent of this module would be, if such instructions are to be executed, or similar examples or similar programs are to be executed, then how do we go about writing it in the assembly language program? So the module objective would be to understand various addressing modes, to gain knowledge about the instructions used in the programming of 8051. To name a few, we have data transfer instructions, the arithmetic instructions, logical instructions, branch instructions, which are bit manipulative instructions. And finally, we will also be writing a small amount of examples, simple and bit complex programs using assembly language program. The learning outcomes would be, that means at the end, when you learn the whole of the module, you'd be able to identify the required addressing modes. Then we'll be able to identify the instructions for a given application or a problem. Then we'll apply the logic and write the assembly program. And finally, we interpret the result for various input test cases. So in this particular session, we will also intend to use Keil Microvision programming, wherein we will see how we can use this Keil Microvision program, execute an assembly program with different test cases and see how the output can be viewed. Next we move on to, I had put just a question over here. The same example that we took, A equal to B plus C, how or what are the ways in which the data can be obtained? So I've given different options, either it is with resistor, fixed data, memory, or any of the above. And we understand that it is any of the above, which means that the data can be bought either from a resistor or there can be a fixed data. Like for example, if you want to add 45 and 55, that's a fixed data which is available to me. Or if at all the data is changing during runtime, usually it will be put into the memory. So all these are the three different ways in which the data can be bought into the processor for processing of the instructions. So let us look into, if these are the three different ways in which the instruction or the data can be bought into, then we'll see what are the different addressing modes. So for any viewing of the data or getting the data, we need to define what are the different operands that are being specified in the instructions. So this operand that we talk about, it can either be a resistor, it can be a data, or it can be a memory location. Then the most important is, what is the rule that is being interpreting or modifying the address field in the instruction before the operand actually is being executed. So this is what defines the addressing mode. So there's a first part of it we'll be having on to understanding what are the different addressing modes depending upon the storage of the data. As you can see, there can be five different ways in which the data can be brought into that defines the addressing mode. The first one, we have it as an immediate type of addressing mode. The second, we have as the direct type of addressing mode. The third, we have it as an indirect type. Then we have the register type, and finally the implicit mode. Let us take each one of them and understand it in a much better way. So here we have the example as move a comma hash 50h. So let us understand little about what is this instruction so that we can understand what is the addressing mode associated with it. So the letter or the word move basically is a mnemonic which tells what is the operation that has to be performed. The next two, that is a comma hash 50, are the two operands. And that is what we defined in an addressing mode, that it requires the operation and the operand. So the data here 50 is available as a part of the instruction, which is defined, which is definite. And that data is being copied into the accumulator A. As we know, A is one of the register as a part of the CPU 8051. So when we have an instruction of this format, wherein the operand, which is the source, is an immediate, a constant value, followed by hash, and then you have the destination to be the register or direct, we call this type of an addressing mode to be as an immediate type of addressing mode. So the advantage we have here is, since the data is already known, you need not spend memory clock cycles to get the data, so you have faster processing, but the drawback is it is being fixed over here. The second type of addressing we have is the register type of addressing mode. As you can see here, both the operands, that is operand 1 as well as operand 2, are both registers. That means the source and the destination are both of the type register. So when you have both of them to be registers, while one of the operand has to be accumulator, then we call this type of register to be as what? I mean, this type of addressing mode to be as register type of addressing mode. So here, when we talk about the register type, any of the registers between R0 to R7 can be used. But most important thing over here is, we cannot have the instruction as move R3, R5 as put as invalid. So if at all you want to move the data from the register R5 to R3, then it is important that we specify the addresses directly. So this is an invalid instruction by writing move R3, R5. This is not permitted in case of the programming of 8051. The next instruction, register addressing mode we have is the direct type of addressing mode. So in the direct type of addressing mode, one of the operand is the memory location. And what memory location? It is the RAM address. As we know, the RAM address can be from 00 to 80H, or rather it is just 7FFH. So all this memory, that is from 00 to 7FH, is there as the direct address. So in this example, if you see, it is move a comma hash 45. So this 45 is the address of a memory location from which the data would be copied into accumulator. So when you have the direct address or the RAM address as a part of the instruction, we call this type of addressing mode to be as what? The direct type of addressing mode. Again, we need to make a note over here that the addresses should be between 0 to 7F. The next one we have is the indirect type of addressing mode. So in the indirect type of addressing mode, it implies that the address of the memory location is directly not available with the instruction. For example, if you want to move, if we have this as the memory location. Let us assume the same address as 45H and assume the content to be as 20H over here. If you want to copy the content of this 20H into the accumulator, I need to point this address 45 to a resistor RI. And this resistor can either be the resistor R0 or the resistor R1. That is what we have given here in specific, saying that it is moved at the rate either RI, A, or it can also be written as move A, at the rate RI. Where I stands to be 0 or 1, that means either it can be a resistor R0 or it can be resistor R1. So important to make a note over here is, in case of an indirect type of addressing mode, only two resistors can be used, that is R0 and R1. And these resistors will be pointing to again only the internal RAM location, which starts from 00 to 7FH. And how do you identify that it is an indirect type of addressing mode? With the symbol, that is at the rate. So whenever you have the resistor R0 or R1 prefixed with the symbol as at the rate, then we call that type of addressing mode to be as an indirect type of addressing mode. The next one we have is the implied type of addressing mode, which means that the instruction is defined by itself. It is a single operand instruction where the instruction operates on the specified resistors only, and to a larger extent these instructions will be operating on the accumulator. Like for example, we have given here RLA, which means rotate left accumulator. The contents of the accumulator are rotated towards the left, so it becomes very implicit. So till now we have discussed all the different types of addressing mode. To be brief, specific enough, we have discussed about the immediate type of addressing mode, we have discussed about the resistor type of addressing mode, we have discussed about the direct type of addressing mode, indirect and implicit. So this becomes the fundamental for us to write the program in order to know from where the data can be accessed upon. Next, let's move on to the instruction set. So whenever a problem is being given, a program, you have to write a program. What is a program? Program is nothing but a set of instructions in a particular sequence to get the desired output. So here we need to understand what is that instruction set, or what are those instructions that have to be studied when you talk about an assembly programming. So the instruction is the one which gives the commands to the processor to tell what it needs to do, right? What is the operation that has to be done? And the syntax of the instruction of an assembly program as listed over here, it consists of the label. Label is a user-defined name, which is not mandatory, right? It may be required or may not be required. Then the most important is the mnemonic. So the mnemonic tells us what is the operation that has to be done on the specified operands. Like for example, in the previous discussion of the addressing mode, we have been writing the instruction as move at the rate RI, A, at the rate RI. So this move is what we call it to be as a mnemonic, which tells what is the operation that has to be performed, followed by which we have the operand 1 and the operand 2. So this operand 1 and operand 2 can either be a resistor or it can be a direct, it can be indirect or immediate, depending upon the type of addressing mode the instruction supports and we need it in our programming. And then finally, the last is the one that is coming, not a part of instruction, but that's very important whenever it is to be documented. So it's always a good practice that we need to document the instructions, or rather in general, the program that we write for. So after having looked into the instruction set, looked into the syntax of what an instruction should be, let us see what are the categories in which the instruction sets is categorized upon. So if you see over there, the instruction set is categorized mainly into four. The first one is the data transfer. So here the data transfer instruction means the movement or copying of the data from one location to another location. As we have seen in the beginning itself, the data can either be in a resistor or it can be into a memory location which can be accessed directly or indirectly, or it can be an implicit or an immediate data. So based on that, you have the instructions which support all these different addressing modes. The next one we have is the arithmetic instructions, wherein, as you know, the different arithmetic operations, I've listed a few, like addition, subtraction, multiplication, whether carry is to be considered, borrow is to be considered or not, are all being defined under the category of arithmetic instructions. The next one we have is the logical instructions. When you talk about the logical, either it can be bitwise or it can be bytewise. So there is a support for both of them. And then finally, we have the conditional type of construction instructions or unconditional under the category of control type of instructions. So when you talk about the instruction set, it consists of five categories. One is we have the data transfer, then we have the arithmetic, then there is logical, which supports byte as well as bit, and then finally we have the control type of instructions. So here, before we go into the details, we'll be discussing each one of them and understand how these instructions operate and be helpful in small little examples that we take up. So the first category that we have is the data transfer instructions. So as you can see, we have in the data transfer five different ways in which the data can be transferred from one location to another location. So it is resistor, data, memory. That means either it can be bought from the resistor or it can be from the data memory. The next one we have is external data memory. So when you want to read the data externally, then it comes under the category of external data memory. The next one we have is the code memory. That means you want to read the data from the ROM location, that is called as the code memory. And then we have exchange, and finally we have the stack memory. That means you want to access the data from the stack memory, then what are the instructions that are being supported? So let us take the first one, data transfer resistor, or it can be from a resistor or and it can be from the memory. So the syntax goes move destination byte comma source byte. So when it is a data transfer instruction, move is the mnemonic. The mnemonic is move. Let us not take the literal meaning of move, that it moves. It basically makes a copy of data from one location to another location. So it is move destination comma source. So how this instruction gets executed is, the contents of the source location would be copied into the destination without altering the contents of the source. So the source contents are not being altered, but a copy of the data from the source would be made into the destination. So what can be source and what can be destination? So here, the destination can either be a resistor or it can be a memory location directly or indirectly. While the source can be a resistor, it can be direct memory or indirectly, and it can also be an immediate data. It can also be an immediate data. Remember, the destination cannot be an immediate data. The reason, when you say immediate data, it's a fixed. How can we copy some x data into a y data where both x and y are being fixed? Fine. So the destination can either be a resistor or it can be a memory location, while the source can either be a resistor or memory directly or indirectly, and finally it can also be an immediate. So in this type of addressing instruction, there is no flag that gets affected. We have already discussed in the first unit the different flags, right, which are there in the program status word. We have the carry flag, the zero flag, there is an auxiliary, there is a negative flag, or which you call it to be as a sign flag, right? So none of these flags get affected when there is a inner data transfer instructions. Next, we move on to the different ways in which this instruction can be used. So let us take the first one, move A, Rn. The first instruction is move A, Rn. So as you can see, the way I have put up on the slide is the instruction followed by the bytes, number of bytes it takes, and what is the operation that is being performed, right? So when you have the instruction being written, ultimately it gets saved, loaded into memory, and it would be loaded in a form of an operational code. So every instruction for us is either move A, R1 or add, subtract. But what again the machine understands, the internal controller understands, is a machine language. So all these instructions have to be encoded and they have to be put up as an operational code. So each of these instructions would occupy certain amount of memory space. And the amount of memory space that is being utilized by this instruction depends upon the addressing mode. Like for example, the first example that we have written is move A, Rn. So we understand this is a resistor type of addressing mode wherein it just requires one byte of the memory space. So when we write this instruction in the program and it is being put on to the memory, then how much space is going to take? Just one byte of the space. So how this instruction works is it copies the content of the resistor Rn into the accumulator A. Now this n can be any value between 0 to 7. That means any resistor R0, R1, R2, R3, R4 up to R7 can be used in this instruction, wherein the data would be copied into the accumulator. So let us take an example over here as move A, R2. Assume before the execution of this instruction, let us say the contents of the accumulator. And we need to remember that all these resistors are 8-bit resistors. So they can store 1 byte of the data. So let us assume that it had a value of 25H. And the resistor R2 has the content of ABH. Okay, and the moment we write H, it means it is a hexadecimal number. And all the data that gets put onto the memory would be in the form of hexadecimal only. So let us get used to the number system hexadecimal than any other. This is before the execution of this instruction. When you execute this particular instruction, after, what happens? The contents of the accumulator would be returned with the contents of the resistor AB. So A, which had 25 before executing, now will be changed with a value of AB. But what happens to the resistor R2? It is not altered, it still retains the value of ABH only. Right? That is what we mean. It just makes a copy of the data from the resistor R2 into the accumulator. The next example, a type of instruction we have, A, direct. So we understand that direct means it is a memory location, and this address should be somewhere between 0 to 7F. the RAM location. So let us take what it does here. The contents of the memory as specified in the direct would be copied into the accumulator. So let us take an example as 30H, which is the RAM location. So before the execution of this instruction, let us say the content of accumulator to be as 25, and we have the memory which I defined here. You have the address starting from 000. Somewhere we have the address as 30H, right? And assume this 30H contains the value as 15H, fine? So once this instruction is being executed, what happens now? This content, which is 15, would be copied into the accumulator. Right? So please remember, this 30 is not the value that gets loaded into A. It is the contents of this memory location, which is 30H, would be put into the accumulator. In this example, we have taken it to be as 15. And what happens to the contents of the memory location after copy? It still will have the value of 15 only. It doesn't get altered. Fine. So this is the second type wherein you can use move instruction in the data transfer. The third type that we have is supporting the indirect as move A comma at the rate RI. And as we said, RI means I stands for either a value of 0 or the value of 1, which means that this can either be resistor R0 or it can be R1. So what we understand by this instruction, we understand that the contents of the memory location is available, the address of the memory location is available in the resistor RI, and its contents, right, would be copied into the accumulator. Okay, so let us understand this much better through an example. Say we have move R0 comma, I use an immediate, say as 35H, and then I write move A comma at the rate R0. Fine. So here we are using the accumulator A, right? And then since it is indirect, obviously we have the memory to be used as another operand. Okay, fine. So what this first instruction does, it's an immediate type of addressing mode. So the resistor R0, whatever was the previous data, will be overwritten with the value of 35H. Fine. So let us see what it is before and what is after. Let us assume that before the execution of this instruction, the contents of R0 is 0, and let us say the contents of A also is 0, and the memory, right, say as 35H contains some data which is FFH, right? So after executing, so what did we say here now? When we look at this instruction, it is R0 is pointing to a memory location whose contents would be copied into accumulator, which we understand. What is R0? R0 is having a 35. So this value 35 is associated with the memory. Okay. So what is the content of this memory? FF would be copied where? Into the accumulator. So after executing, the contents of R0 would be 35H, right? Which means that it is pointing to the location 35 in the memory, and what is the value in that is FFH, right? And then this data, which is FF, it would be were bought into the accumulator. I hope I'm making it clear to you all. I repeat once again, when you use the instruction indirectly, that is move A, at the rate RI, the resistor RI would point to a memory location whose contents would be copied into the destination resistor, that is accumulator. Okay, so in this example, before the execution of these two instructions, we see that R0 is 0, A is also 0, and the memory location, that is 35H, contains FFH. After executing, what happens? This R0 will contain 35. Since we are using indirect with the reference of the resistor R0, now R0 would be pointing to the memory location, which is 35. I'll just write it over here. Yeah, which is 35. And what are the contents of that memory location 35? Is nothing but FFH. So after executing this instruction, the value FF would be copied into accumulator and not this 35. Okay, right. So the next we have is a pretty simple one. After understanding this complex ones, is move A comma hash data. Okay, so what is the data now? Data is a immediate value which has to be a 8-bit data, because the destination resistor accumulator is also 8-bit. So hash data would be an 8-bit ones. So it requires how many bytes of the memory space? It will occupy 2 bytes of the memory. So once if you write move A comma hash 0ABH, after executing this instruction, what will be the contents of accumulator? If you say before, it was 00. So after executing, the contents of A would be loaded with ABH. Please note, any value that you write between A and F, or rather A to F, should be prefixed with the 0. It's not O, it's a 0. Otherwise, it would give an error saying that it's a variable not identified as a numeral. Right. The next one we have is move Rn, direct. So this is again a 2-byte instruction where the destination is a resistor and source is the direct, which means it is the direct address, any RAM address between 0 to FF. So if you say move, which one are we doing, is Rn, right? Rn, n can again take any value between 0 to 7. If you say move R3, say 50H. So before the instruction execution, if you say the contents of R3 is 40H and the memory location at 50H, assume that it is 10H. After executing the instruction, R3 would contain what? This, that is 10H, while the memory location at 50H would still be 10H. Okay, this is how you can use the direct address as a part of the instruction. The next instruction that we have is move Rn, A. A pretty simple, straightforward, wherein the contents of the accumulator would be copied into the resistor Rn. For example, we can say move R4, A. So what is this R4 and A, right? Both are resistors. Assume that R4 has the value say as 50H, right? And the contents of the accumulator, A, let us assume before the execution to be as 26H, right? So after executing, again this is a one byte instruction, right? So when you execute this, what will happen? After executing, the contents of R4, right, would be loaded with the contents of the accumulator, which is 26H, while the contents of accumulator A would still be 26H. Hope I'm making it clear to you all. The next one we have is Rn, comma, hash data. That means whenever you want to load a deleted type of data, then we can go in for using this instruction, that is move Rn, comma, hash data. For example, we will say move R0, comma, hash 22H. So the value 22 would be loaded into the resistor R0. Now, if you look at all these instructions that we have seen, it operates on byte. You are just copying a byte of data. Either it could be an immediate data, as in this example, or you are copying the data from a resistor, which is again a byte data, or you are copying the data from the memory, which is again byte, or you are copying the data from a memory pointed by the resistor. Fine. All the instructions till now we have seen are the ones which support byte. But if there is a need of loading a 16 bit of a data into the resistor, then we will be using the resistor, that is DPTR, data pointer. So as we have seen in the programming model of 8051, all the resistors are 8 bit except the program counter and the DPTR. So DPTR is a resistor which is of a 16 bit, that is 2 byte. So whenever we have a 16 bit of the data to be loaded, we use the resistor, that is DPTR. So we have the support of the instruction as move DPTR, comma, immediate data. Right? And as we know, DPTR consists of DPH and DPL, and each are 8 bit resistors. So this is obviously going to be a 3 byte instruction because it's operating 16 bit of the data. So let us consider an example as move DPTR, comma, hash 2672H, right? And before the execution of this instruction, if the contents of DPTR, say assume is ABCD, then after executing the contents of DPTR, as we said, would be in turn with two resistors, DPH and DPL. So 72 would be copied into the resistor byte, lower byte of DPTR as DPL, and 26 would be copied into higher byte of the DPTR. And further, they can be individually accessed for any operations to be done. But main intent is, whenever you have a 16 bit of the data, then obviously we have to go in for using DPTR, which can hold 16 bits of the data. If you have any queries, it can be put into the chat or you can raise across so that we can just clarify the doubts there. The next one that we have is move direct, comma, direct. So what it means over here is direct is a memory address. Which address again? It's a RAM address between 0 to 7F. So again, it's a 3 byte instruction. It is move, for example, let us say 35H, comma, 42H. So what is that 35 and 42? So 35 is the destination memory address and the source is a 42. So before executing, obviously it's going to be associated with the memory 35, and somewhere we have it as 42, right? So before the execution of the instruction, if the content of 35H is 14H and 42 is ABH, right? Then what happens now? After the instruction is being executed, what is there in 42 would be copied into 35, which means that this 14H would be overwritten with ABH. This is how the instruction move direct comma direct works. The next one we have is move direct comma RN, right? Move direct comma RN, where RN is again a resistor. So it's a 2-byte instruction. Again, if you take an example, say as R3, assume that with the same example previously, before executing this instruction, 35, let it contain AB, and let us say R3 contains some value, say as 10H. Fine. So after executing this instruction, what happens? The value 10H would be returned into the memory location, that is 35H. The third one we have, or rather the next one we have, is move direct comma at the rate RI. Fine. So again, this instruction is associated with the memory itself, but the destination is the direct address, while the source is an indirect type of addressing that we have. So let us consider the example. We'll say move R1 comma hash 23H, and then you write move 0ABH comma at the rate R1. Okay, so let us consider the memory before execution. So by the way it is being written, we understand now R1, though it contains an immediate data 23, now it is not simply a data, but it is an address of a memory location, the RAM address. So this is 23, which is being obtained by the resistor R1, or other R1 points to the memory 23, and we have the address AB. Fine. So before executing the instruction, let us assume that this memory 23 has the data say as 45, which is hexadecimal, and the memory AB, assume that it is being cleared, has data to be 00. So when you execute this instruction, what happens? R1, which was previously said to be a 00, would be overwritten with the value of 23, which means that it is pointing to a memory location which is 23. And when you execute the second instruction, that is move ABH comma at the rate R1, what it will do now? The address 23 pointed by the resistor R1 contains the value 45. Fine. And this value 45 would be copied into the memory, that is AB. So 0 would be overwritten by 45H. So here we have the source as well as a destination to be memory, but the source data is being obtained indirectly, right, through the resistor R1. I hope I'm making it clear. find these instructions related to data transfer, the first category. The next that we have is move direct comma hash data, a pretty simple one. Whenever you want to load the memory directly with some predefined value, you can use this instruction. Again, I tell you, it should be a 8-bit data. So we can say move 27H comma hash 10H. So what happens now? The value 10 would be copied into the RAM location 27H on executing this instruction. So this is again a 3-byte instruction. The next one we have is move direct comma A. So this basically deals with the data transfer happening between the accumulator and the RAM memory. For example, move 29H comma A. Okay, this is the example. So before the execution of this instruction, let us assume that A contains some value as CD and the memory at the location 29H may contain say value as 10H. So on executing the instruction, that is after executing, what happens? The contents of this accumulator, which is CD, would be copied where? Into the memory location, that is 29. So 10 would be replaced with the, would be CD. Right? It would be replaced with a value of CD. So contents of accumulator, which is CD, would be copied into the memory location 29. So 10 is replaced with the value of CD. The next one we have is an indirect, wherein we have already discussed one of the instruction as move A comma at the rate R naught. Now the other form, that is move at the rate RI comma A. So previously we did as what? Move A comma at the rate RI, wherein indirect addressing mode was the source. Now that indirect addressing mode is the destination. Okay, so let us understand this instruction with an example. Let us write move R1 comma hash 49H and then move at the rate R1 comma A, the accumulator. So we have accumulator containing some value 5H, then R1 containing some value say as 10H, then obviously we are going to have the memory with some data put into. This is before the execution. Whatever I wrote in black is before. So now what happens after you execute? Right? After executing the instruction. The first instruction gets executed. So what happens to the register R1? Instead of 10, it would be with a value of 49H. Right? Now, when you look at this instruction, what this instruction does? The contents of R1 would be loaded with the contents of A. Okay? The contents of R1, that is pointing a memory location, would be loaded with the contents of A. So what are the contents of accumulator? Is 5. And where R1 is pointing? Now R1, which is 49, means it's going to point to the memory location, which is 49H. Okay, it's going to point to the memory location, which is 49H. And what are the contents of those 49? We don't know. It may have some data. Now it would be overwritten with what value? With a value of 5H. I hope it's clear. Okay. So accumulator has some value 5H. R1 is pointing to the memory which is 49. And previously there is some data in the memory location at 49H. On executing this instruction, the value 5 would be copied into this memory location 49 indirectly through the resistor R1. Fine. The next one that we have other form of the data transfer, that is move, is move at the rate RI, comma data. Which means you want to load some predefined data or immediate data into a memory location.
I think we're done.
Yeah. Okay. So with the memory location, this I think we are done with the time, right? So I'll quickly brief on what we have done in today's class. In today's class, we have the recap of previous module 1. Then we have started with the module 2, discussing about the addressing modes, discussing about the instructions, and we have just started off with the data transfer instructions. So we'll carry forward the data transfer instructions in the next class. Thank you.